Hello and welcome back to the Get Stuff Done podcast with myself, Gordon Dudley. Happy New Year to everybody. It's great to be back. And once again, we have a fantastic guest lined up for you today who absolutely is on target with everything that we stand for in getting stuff done. His name is Leo Tony Dandel. He is representative for Lufthansa here in Korea. He has actually been with Lufthansa Group for 32 years. He has worked for them in more than six different countries, and he speaks five different languages. So I'm sure you'll agree he will have a lot to share with us on today's podcast. I've known him for a little while now. We've actually been connected originally through the European Chamber of Commerce in Korea. And so Leo, thank you for being a guest today.
It's my pleasure. Thanks for the invitation.
Wonderful. So first of all, I'd like to get into our custom questions that we have every episode on the Get Stuff Done podcast. So before we go into more detail about the international career that you've had, and I love the fact that you're sat in front of a world map, which I think must be representative of what you do. We can talk about that in more detail in due course. But first, what is it for you that's important about getting stuff done?
Well, I think it's part of our life, right? So, moving around different countries, getting to know different people, different realities, different cultures. It's all about being adaptable at the end of the day, right? But also, it's also a great deal of ambition that we have. And the fact that at the end of the day, we want to leave. When I leave my positions, I want to have an impact behind. And this is always my goal, that we are moving forward, we are not moving backwards. And to move forward, we have to think sometimes and very often out of the box. And that it takes a lot of time, energy, not only from me, but also the teams that I work with.
I fully agree, and I think what you've already hit on is the reason I wanted to get you on as a guest, because I don't think you are a typical corporate executive, even though you might have been with one company for such a long time. You've been involved in so many different areas of business in so many different regions, and so clearly they recognize you as someone who is able to get the job done, and that's obviously a really critical part when you are in a management role responsible for so many different areas of the business. On a more personal note, when you said about making an impact, what is it that you feel kind of has led you to adopt that mindset? What is it that, made you into somebody who wants to have an impact?
I think it has a lot to do with how I was brought up. You mentioned about being in different countries. I was born in Brazil, right? So it's a huge country where you learn a lot, where you work way differently in comparison to any other place, the same way we do in Korea, of course. But there was a huge, learning curve for me, especially my first job. When I started with Lufthansa, I did a customer service job. And I learned how important it was to work with a team, as a team, with different people, different backgrounds, different understanding and perspectives as well. So I think this was for me a huge motivation towards the impact at that time, impact towards customers, because you are dealing with customers directly. But also on top of that, I also learned because through my university time and also my time starting with the company, that I needed to really to make sure that I was delivering a good job at the end of the day. So I was hired to do something, a job, and I wanted to be the best, right? So I always try my best to deliver, and I learned along the way quite a lot, yeah? And I never gave up in a sense that, yeah, something went wrong today and I will not do that anymore. I think it was the contrary, right? So if I learned things that most probably the first try was not positive, and I always try to turn that around. And that, I think, this create lasting impacts in the end of the day towards the company, also employees, but also the customer in the end of the day, because you always have opportunities to turn negative things into positive things.
Yes, I think that's a really good consideration, is that no matter how bad things are, there's always that opportunity. And so, did you join Lufthansa directly out of university?
Yeah, good question. Actually, not. I joined Lufthansa while I was at university. So basically, I came back from Germany, and right after, I don't know, 3 months after that, I got a job at Lufthansa, and 6 months after, I went into university. Right. So it was my first university degree. So what I did, I worked very odd times. I started at 3 o'clock in the morning and worked until 8 o'clock in the morning. So it was a part-time job. And I did my university a night course. So this means that I slept during the day and I studied during the day and I ran my life during the day. And it was a very interesting time of my life. I was, of course, young, single, but I have to juggle, family and friends, because when you work with customer service at the airport, you work any time of the week, right? It's no Monday to Friday, it's 9 to 5, the contrary. So again, I think for me it was a great entry. It was a great entry to a corporate life, because really you realize how many people is behind operations, how many people make sure that the airplanes leaves on time, arrive on time, customers process correctly, and they are happy at the end of the day, that they're delivering that experience, this dream experience people want to have when they travel with us. And I think this was, for me, fantastic times, I have to say. Yeah, different, very unusual, but I love it.
I mean, and your track record is the evidence of that dedication that you put in from such an early stage. That's fantastic. I mean, I just saw a quick video earlier today, which is talking about people complaining that they don't have time to pursue their real dreams because they're too busy working in their 9 to 5. But of course, the reality is that what there are 129 days a year that we're not working, even when we have our 9 to 5. And I think talking about your utilization of the 24-hour period to really get everything in is a great example of that. And there's someone else that I'm good friends with here in Korea. He came to do his MBA whilst he was in Korea, and he so badly wanted to get a job in Korea that he started working whilst studying. So very similar to you. So he was going to work directly 6, 7 p.m., working through till 2 a.m., and then getting up at 6 in order to do his studies, and then to be back in class for 9. So, he said it was the toughest part of his life, but he learned so much about his capabilities and capacity. And I think maybe that's something that's not talked about enough, is that capability is one thing, but capacity is another thing, and we don't really know our true capacity until we really test our limits. And we're so much more capable than we believe, based on what we think we can do. So it seems like you already set the bar very high for yourself from an early age. And so then you continued working for Lufthansa in Brazil, or did your international career begin right away?
Yeah, I shift jobs in Brazil. So I moved from customer services to a sales job. And after 6 months, I was lucky enough to be part of the America's project. So it was a total quality management project that we had in place throughout North, Central, and South America. So I was representing Brazil in that project. And there was the time that I started to get way more involved with performance, productivity, people, processes, and results, right? So we talked about impact in the beginning. This is all about the right impact, right? The quality impact, the lasting impact that we talked about all the time. And this is also where it was when I started having a different spin or understanding on what I could be able to do. Yes, the sales job was very was a great. I was super happy with that. But right after that, I moved into project management. I did that parallel to my job with Lufthansa as well. And from there, I did 2 3 years, 2 years, and I moved to London, to the UK.
Great city. London has my vote. How did you find London? We're talking the 90s here, right? What am I, where are we? Just to.
We are talking, yeah, 90s. No, I'm not that old. 2000, 2001, 2001 to 2007. I was in London. I normally say I arrived there single and I left with a wife and two kids.
Well, there you go. How long did that take?
6 years in
6 years,
total.
you're in London. All right. And so a question I always ask people who have been with one organization for such a long time is, what is it that kept you? How is it that, in an environment of ever-shortening tenure and absolutely no more job for life, what is it that you can say that's kept you for 32 years with the
Yeah,
same?
that's a great question because I ask myself that question quite often. And it's a good point for reflection. Because, I mean, Lufthansa Group is a large, is a very big company that is growing over the years. It's also consolidating. What I realize is that, yes, we can sit down and do the same job forever. I mean, 25 years doing the same tasks. But with a company so large, there are so many different opportunities you can do if it's that aligned to what you want to achieve with your life, right? So, and I learned very early because of this introduction to project management, to international business, that the world is way more or way bigger than what I was doing there. Yeah, at that time when I started. Yeah, and that was actually a big motivator for me to progress and move jobs. I mean, every 4 or 5 years I do a different job. So it doesn't mean that this over these 32 years I'm doing the same job. Totally the contrary. I am doing different jobs every 4 or 5 years, and this is also something that you learn a lot. But also for you to do this job, you have to learn on top, right? I think this self-learning and lifelong learning process. I think this is also part of my who I am. I'm not a type of person who comes with the same solution for the same problems solving all the time. The contrary, I think we can use our brains really to make sure that we find different alternatives and different problems different solutions for problems. And this is, I believe, is something that is driving me through the company, right? So it also means that everywhere in our lives we have up and downs. So this is also part of life. I have to consider that, but also have to learn with that, right? So it's our choice at the end of the day to consider: do I keep on that track or we move the track? And this is something that also realize that if you put yourself out there with your skills and but also showing what you're capable of, I think you always have a chance.
Yeah, and I have met you, and the conversations that we have had have told me right away that you're a very culturally empathetic leader. I think you consider that to be highly important, and you've just literally mentioned about the way in which you differentiate your approach and solution to the problem, which is one of the key points to that. So you said six countries that you've worked in. Is there one country that you would highlight as being the most challenging, and why was it the most challenging for you?
Good question. I think I got different challenges everywhere I was, and it was totally unexpected. I think the only expected place where I believe we would have challenges, it would be my first turn in Korea. Why? Because at that time I was leading a startup project for the company. So we are opening a new destination. So basically, when I landed in Busan, we didn't have staff, we didn't have offices, we didn't have anything. So we started from scratch. This was in 2006, right? And I
2007.
stayed there for, and I stayed 4.5 years there. And when I left, I was grateful because not only the operations were running on a profitable level, but we built a great team. And this team is still with us working for us in Korea. This was for me extremely how can I express myself on that? I was super happy when I came back here to Korea to see the colleagues in Busan still doing a great job, right? So it was not only the right decisions, but they also realized that they also could build their own future with the company. Yeah, but this was an expected challenge, right? So and then I moved to Jakarta, and this was, you know, things happens there that I could not even imagine. Yeah, so I think after 6 months, I was told, yeah, Leo, we will need to stop to fly to Indonesia, and I was not counting on that. And I was taken by surprise. Honestly, I think the first 2 days I was saying, okay, what I do next? Why I moved from Korea? Just for me to come to my next step, which was, okay, the same way we stop flying, we can restart, right? And we managed that after 8 months. So, and it was a huge challenge for me, I have to say. And this is where I learned a lot, not only from the place where I was working, the cultural the cultural impact, but from other people. People that, not only people like you, for example, people involved with other organizations that deals with government on a daily basis, right? So I think this for me was a huge learning curve that opened huge opportunities for me on my next appointment, right, or my next jobs. Even here today in Korea, this still helps me. So this is, I think Indonesia was a huge challenge. And then I moved to Norway, right? So a total extreme, if you really think through it, yeah. Where everything's transparent, there is no hierarchies, it's more dynamic, high digitalized everything, but it's still challenging, right? It doesn't mean it's not challenging. The cultural aspect in Scandinavia is way harder for me at that time to catch up with. But we did, and then at the end of the day, and then we dealt also with, you know, closures and reopenings or inaugurations of destinations. So everything happened, yeah, but I think we did that quite well because of my previous experience. And that's what it happens, right? So we learn with these challenges, with this experience, to make your next job an even better experience.
And so you mentioned about lifelong learning and taking away those experiences. Are there any specific kind of tangible techniques or things that you do to accumulate, to kind of really crystallize what it is that you have learned along the way?
I think my goal for myself is always to be the most productive person. And to get there, you have to learn a lot, not learn about yourself, but also learn from other people, but different tools, right? So I think nowadays we live in a world with a lot of technology enablers, and I think this also supports us a big time. We are way more productive because of that. But even before all this technology revolution, I think for me, it was important to have a good theoretical basics in a variety of different areas that I can think about, that I could reflect upon my reality at that time. And this, I took that with me. I still use it, of course. I mean, very often I go back to my books and look and I reread certain things, not only to remember, but really to make sure that I read correctly the first time around. And I think we are moving in a totally different direction. So technology is enabling us to run things more digital, be more quicker. We can do different jobs at the same time. Yeah, I think the same happens not only with us, but the people that we manage. I think they also go into the same exercises and the same experience, right? And also gives you a different perspective on how you can achieve or bring impact to other people or to the business. I think this is also for me important that, yes, we get the results we want, but how do you get there? I think for me it's not what you do. It is important what you do, but also how do you do? I think this is even more important. Nowadays, this is way more important than, I don't know, 10 years ago.
Absolutely. And so it seems, though, that with all that being said, that you clearly have a very good personal system for managing all of that. Can you just let us know what is the current scale of the operations and people that you're responsible for, because I'd really like to get to know how it is that you can be responsible for all of that, and also, you know, with your goal of having the most productive day ever, how that really works. So can you tell us a bit about that?
Yeah, I can tell you about it. Yeah, it's important question, actually, because in Korea, we are a small team. We are not a big team, but what we do here sometimes is remarkable, right? So the other day I wrote an email to a friend, and I told her, I said, listen, I don't know that this guy have a limit, because I think we don't know that limit anymore. The amount, the productivity levels of our team here is pretty high. We are launching a new brand now. We're increasing frequencies. We are putting more seats on the market. We were the first airline to bring a lot more capacity to Korea right after the pandemic. So we are building from that. And I think this is also something that we realize that everything is possible if we are disciplined on the way we deliver it. So for the team, the message was always like, what we have done before does not necessarily apply nowadays. So we were always reviewing what we were doing in the past, what needs to be done in the future, what we have to stop doing that does not apply anymore. So the whole process of evaluating working processes that, yes, we carry on doing certain tasks, we stop others, and we start new ones that will achieve way more than we did before. So I think with that mindset, yes, of course, you have to have this minimum critical mass of size for you to achieve the greatest results. But on the other hand, and if you had priority on that, and people, they can read your ambition, I think, and we bring everybody on board, I think it doesn't matter how big your team is. I think it is just a matter of, you know, of marching towards that goal, finding solutions for these new challenges that we never did before, right? So we are doing things nowadays that we didn't do 6 months ago. Yeah, so, and this continuous change in, you know, or adaptability, let's say, on problem solving or opportunity finding, I think this is what drives us forward. Also important to say is not only that, I think everybody has to have a decent amount of an ambition level also to move on, right? And this we have to create, yeah? Some people, they don't, some people, they do. And this is something that we have to create. This is a little seed that you have to plant and water over time that people, they realize that, you know, we have to move on. Yeah. And we only move on if we really achieve something higher and higher. So and I think this is and the tree gets bigger. Right. So I think this is my motto here with the team, and works quite well in Korea.
This might be the million or billion dollar question, but I'm going to ask it. How do you make sure that seed germinate? How do you grow that ambition with people when sometimes not everybody you know, shows that outwardly, or even outwardly they show that they don't have it? How do you go about trying to, you know, galvanize and stimulate that ambition that you just mentioned?
Well, that's a great question, I have to say, because everybody's different. Everybody's different. The same way I talk to you, I will not talk to my neighbor, yeah, for example. I will have a totally different approach. And the same applies to the team, right? So not everybody's ambition, but you find one, you find two, you find three, and then they talk to each other, and they want to compete with each other at the end of the day. So their ambition will come one way or the other, right? So I think everybody wants to look good at a picture. Let's put that way at the end of the day. But sometimes you also have people that they are also okay with the status quo. Yeah, but it doesn't mean that we should give up. I think it always comes down to the fact how we bring this over to the people, right? So people have different perspective, and we have to deliver the message differently. I think this is also part, we live in a world that is transforming itself so often at the moment, so quickly. And the same applies to us. This transformation, the way we lead people, the way people want to be led, or the way that people want to work, is also being transformed. And I think we have to consider that, right? So, and that's what I said in the beginning, or just earlier. The way we find solutions for our problems nowadays is not the same way we did 6 months ago, because our business also transforming very, very quickly, right? So you have competition, you have demand, you have different generations, and people, expectations and perspectives are different, and we have to tackle that. We have to understand that before we jump in and engage.
Yeah, so I mean, new ways of working, how to design them, what is it that people want? I would love to talk to you, but that probably is an episode in itself that we could discuss on that. So let me ask maybe a more straightforward question. What does a typical day look like for you?
Yeah, good. I come to the office around 8:30, 9 o'clock. By the time I arrive in the office, I have my emails done overnight because of the time difference. I take a subway to the office, so I have that time, the luxury of time, again, to work in my emails. By the time I arrive in the office, I have a packed agenda very often, and I really jump into the matters that we have planned. So a strategic planning for us is also very important, and we have always something to tackle, right? So I prefer to have days where we produce. We produce solutions, we produce performance, rather than just answering emails, right? So I also put my emails on the second level of response, let's put it that way, so I deprioritize that. I prioritize more tasks that bring us forward, yeah? I think also emails that I'm not directly addressed to. So if I'm copying in, it does not even come to my main mailbox anymore. So I let them go to a different email box, and then at one day I will go back and check that out. But for me, it's important that we are bringing our business forward, and this is what I tend to do from the time I arrive and the time I leave. So I don't have time to go home. It doesn't sound good, right? The reason why is we have a time difference with Germany, so we have a lot to catch up very often. But again, because of technology and this technology enabling us different tools, so I can do this catch-ups on the go very often. So very flexible, I have to say. I also have this opportunity to be in a position that I can give this flexibility to our team members, but also can get this flexibility from my leadership. And this is also great, right? So this is all we need, not to finish at 5 o'clock. I'm also a big believer that the work can be done any time of the day, anywhere. And right. This is also something that this time.
Work is not just a place, right? Work is something that we do, right?
Correct. Exactly. Exactly that.
So you mentioned also that you speak 5 languages. Tell us what are those 5, and then perhaps a little bit about how they have helped you in the path of your career.
Yeah, good question. So I was born in Brazil, right? So we always at home we always spoke in Portuguese in Brazil. Yeah, I come from a family that. Family of immigrants, Italian immigrants to Brazil, and you have a lot of those people in Brazil, so we are one of it. And very often, these families, they speak their own language, right? So Italian, in our case, the case of my dad, so he came from a place in Italy that they speak Italian and German. But again, most of my German I learned in Germany. I went to school in Germany as well, so I did all my high school in Germany. So this is where I could, improve my German quite a lot. Brazilian or Portuguese? I'm sorry, the Portuguese Brazilian is very close to Spanish. So when in Brazil we say we speak Portunhol, which is a mix of Portuguese and Spanish. and English, right? So English you learn in school in Brazil, but I had opportunity also to polish my English over time. I did a stint of university in US, and I work again 6 years in your country, and there I think I could practice a lot of English at that time.
Got it. And how you know, languages are one of the transferable skills that we know, and you have an abundance of them. How important have languages been in your career, or if they are not so important, would you have another transferable skill which you consider to be more important?
I think languages are very important skills because it's not about speaking the language, it's about understanding the culture. I think and this is one of things that I keep that in mind if we are going to a new place, because the language makes your understanding of a particular culture much easier. The way people talk, the way people think, also is very much related to how they speak, how they approach things. And I think this is also something that I would imagine it is key to understand the language perspective. I think nowadays with English, I think you go around absolutely everywhere in the world. German is a special language for us because we're a German company at the end of the day. I don't use the other languages that much in my day-to-day work, but I could if I would need to have that need, especially with diplomats, for example, in Korea. But on the other hand, I think this cultural awareness or the cultural awareness impact that the language brings to you. About other transferable skills, I think is this lifelong learning. I think this is also something that I try always to be repetitive towards the teams that I work with, because for you to achieve this lasting impact, you just do that if you're up to speed what's going on around us. Because otherwise it's not lasting, right? So it's just impact right here, right now, and it's gone, right? And this is what I try, honestly, my best to be repetitive enough that people, they can, not only repetitive, but convincing enough that this is one big asset we should have.
There might be some of our listeners who are not yet C-level, have not yet reached executive management, and they maybe aspire to do so, but they maybe think, gosh, how on earth is it possible to get everything done in a day? Like, if I'm going to get to that level, I'm surely going to have to work, you know, essentially 7 days a week, always be online. But I think it's clear that that's not an absolute requirement. Can you tell us a little bit about that, especially because you mentioned about trying to have always the most productive day you can. Can you explain a little bit about that? Or maybe perhaps are there parts of your journey where you did work that type of crazy schedule, which you considered to be an investment, an important part, versus how it is now and how you balance it?
Yeah, I think there are different requirements for different jobs, I believe, and different time also when it comes to where the business is, how mature the business is. I think if you're dealing with a startup, if you have your own business and a small team, I think you have a different dynamics, also in terms of involvement, but also in terms of delivery and when things need to be delivered. This is one aspect we have to consider. I think at the end of the day, it is about discipline, right? So that we watch ourselves carefully. I think my major focus is that I have a fresh brain to start the next day. I think that's important for me. That I don't go into a overburned situation that, yeah, we work, and at the end of the day, you don't achieve much. I think productivity is extremely related to how much you can process and how good the quality of this process is. And this is what my full discipline is all about. I don't expect anyone here to work overnight in the contrary. So if somebody's doing, there's something wrong with that, and I tackle that as well, because the amount of workload that we have should be able, we should be able to do in times that we are fresh to do that. Yeah, so I'm not saying 9 to 5. I'm talking about any time that people feel more comfortable. However, I think we should also allow us time to, put your head on the pillow and turn your brain off, because this needs to be fresh the next day.
I think that's a fantastic takeaway, that it's about ultimately productivity, and the productivity, as per your definition, is being able to process the information like you mentioned, and that cannot be done if we are always on. So I fully agree with your stance on that. So what would you say then? We talked a bit about transferable skills. Now you've been, I think you said 4.5 years the first time in Korea, now 2 years in Korea. What would there be any different skill or maybe a particular skill which is in greater need for working in Korea? I just want to bring it to our local country where we're both sitting right now, even though we're neither of us.
Excellent question. You're right about that. Yes, I think the key word here is communication. How we interact, how we communicate with each other, in different depth, but also level of details, and also the level of empathy. As I mentioned before, I think everybody has different perspective. Also in Korea, they have different perspectives. And I think we have to understand that perspective first before we engage, right? So, but the way we talk is extremely linked on how we do things, how we turn things around. And communication for me is key, also when it comes to transferable skills. Quality of communication, right? Amount of communication, how you communicate. Communicate can be the way we are doing right now, can be in meetings, can be on these productivity tools that we have available nowadays, right? Can be a little call, even a check-in call, yeah? If somebody's sick, so yeah, pick up the phone and show them that you are also worried about them. Yeah, so I think this the empathy, to be close to people, especially the teams that you are managing. I think this is extremely important, and this is something that I learned over time. But if you compare Korea at that time nowadays, I think Korea moved miles away in comparison to 2007, and what I see in Korea is still the pali-pali culture we have here. However, people, they are more aware of, a life-work balance, yeah? Mm-hmm. So they understand them better. I think 15 years ago, this didn't exist in their dictionary. And then they are there. So I think they're bringing also a great amount of quality to their daily lives, and that's important as well. And I like that, because the conversations we have is way more enriching.
Fully agree. I mean, it's the question that didn't exist in Korea some time ago, which is, when is this due by? That was just a non-existing question. Correct. In Korea. But it's, of course, incredibly important for anybody assigning tasks to make it clear how important it is, and if there are any specific deadlines that need to be met, so that people can organize their work accordingly and do it in the most productive way.
Yeah, right.
On that note, I'm sorry to say that we're out of time, Leo. I want to say a big thank you to you for being our guest and sharing all of your insights built up over your international career with Lufthansa Group. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Thanks for having me. It was a pleasure.
And thank you to everybody who is listening and watching. We really appreciate you following the podcast that we put out on a weekly basis. I would really appreciate you give us a subscribe so that you can keep up to date with the weekly episodes as they come out every Thursday. I, from my side, will endeavor to keep bringing you really great guests, a wide variety of backgrounds who have really deep insights and fantastic experiences to share with you on the Get Stuff Done podcast. Thank you so much, and see you again on the next episode.